Now I will talk something about the Hilbert space, the different parameters we will compare, and I hope you will understand that thing more. So, come to Hilbert space. Vector space was a three-dimensional space, and in vector space you can resolve any vector in its component. Now Hilbert space is not dealing with a vector, but Hilbert space is dealing with a function, right? Hilbert space is dealing with a function. How many components are there for a vector? Three only. They are not more than three. And how many components a function have? Infinite number of components. I say that n number of components, which we call polynomials as well. So now to resolve a function into its individual components, how many orthonormal bases we should have? Again, n number of bases we should have. Let's say psi 1 of x, psi 2 of x, psi 3 of x, so on up to psi n's of x. If they are orthonormal in nature, if these are orthonormal functions, bases, orthonormal functions, then I will say that these can be the bases of Hilbert space, right? Just like a vector space. Now these will follow some conditions as well. So the very first condition will be, that they are supposed to be orthonormal. Orthonormal means that when you multiply psi 1 of x with psi 2 of x, then you know that your functions you cannot multiply like this because they may have some complex portion. And complex numbers are always multiplied a conjugate and the other. If they will not be complex, then they will remain the same. No problem with this one. But if the wave functions will be complex, then this multiplication will not be right. And then we will have to write like this, integrate in dx, and this is equal to delta mn. We know this thing. So it means if they are following now, if this is 1 and this is 2, 2 and 3, 1 and 3 and all these with one another, then I'm, instead of writing 1 and 2, I write m and n here, where m is running from 1 to, where n is running from 1, 2, 3, so on, n is running from 1, 2, 3, so on. If these indices will become the same, then we will have 1 here. If they will be different than one another, then we will have 0 here, right? So it is actually this condition which we wrote in a compact form. So these can serve as the basis of a space, the very first thing. Now you remember that we wrote, so what will be like Hilbert space? It will be in n-dimensional space, though we cannot sketch the n-dimensional space on a two-dimensional setup, right? We cannot draw it. But if this is psi 1, this is psi 2, this is psi 3, psi 4 and so on, this is psi n, then each of them are actually perpendicular to each other. And if I will have a function f of x, or this function is big psi of x, for example, then this big psi of x will be in this space, just like our vector here. And this big psi we will write in terms of summation on n from 1 to infinity, Cn, and then psi n of x we will write like this, because look here, when you will expand this one, then what it will be? It will be capital psi n, capital psi of x will be equal to c1 psi 1 of x plus c2 psi 2 of x plus c3 psi 3 of x and so on. This psi x is actually our function which we are resolving into components, just like this one. Over there we are having capital psi, here we are having r. Now this is the component, this is the coefficient, and this is the basis. Coefficient multiplied with basis, coefficient multiplied with basis, coefficient multiplied with basis, just like vector space. Coefficient multiplied with the basis, coefficient, basis, coefficient, basis. Right? You got it? So in order to, means this one is having infinite number of components and we are having infinite number of bases, so infinite number of components will also come in there. Now if I want to find out that what is C1, come back here. If you want to find out what is X, then what you do? In order to find out X, I multiply this R with X unit vector. Okay? I multiply this R with X unit vector. Then what it will give me? If I multiply X unit vector here, then it will be here. XX will give you 1. So it will give you X. And then all the other terms will come out to be 0 due to the orthonormality condition. Look here. I want to find now C1. So what I will do? I will multiply this one with the conjugate of this one. So it will be psi 1 of x. And then this is psi of x. Forget about the conjugate now for a moment. If I multiply it with this, then I will get C1. But there is a problem between that and this one. This can be complex as well. And in order to deal with the complex, we will have to write conjugate. Clear? And these are functions, these are not vectors, these are functions, so we will have to integrate them as well on along the line, and we will get C1. This thing is called Fourier trick. This is Fourier trick. This is not Fourier. Okay? He was a French mathematician and it is called Fourier. This R is completely silent. So the Fourier trick is this one, that you do like this, that Cn, C Cn of this one is from minus infinity to plus infinity, and sine n conjugate and f of x dx. If your f of x is capital psi of x, this one is capital psi, then you will write it like this. Clear? So it is as easy as this one. The only difference, three-dimensional, n-dimensional. Orthonormal basis, right? You expand a vector or define a vector in that space. Here you expand a function or define a function in this space, right? So the in the last lecture, the trick that we did in order to find these coefficients, then this will be equal to, this will be equal to means the C and the coefficients we will find. Now over here, out of all this, the components of this one, it will pick only the one which it will be along. The other will give you 0 and 0. Clear? Now look another way. If I want the magnitude of this vector r, then I write, then this will be x square plus y square plus z square and square root. So I will say that the magnitude of this is equal to 1. Now, what this means, means the square of this one plus the square of this one plus the square of this one. I can now write x square plus y square plus z square will be equal to 1. Means individual all components, if I sum up, then they will be equal to 1 when my vector will be a unit vector. Means it is having magnitude equal to 1. So the same thing we wrote for here. These are the components, these are the coefficients. So over here, if I write the sum on Cn mod square on n from 1 to infinity will always be equal to 1. Right? So this Cn is actually the x, y, z in the vector space. So 1 is the vector space, the other is the Hilbert space, and this, I hope now your understanding will be much improved with this comparison. That what is meant by a space, how we resolve a function in a space. Over there we are dealing only with vector. You cannot treat a function here, because a function is having infinite number of components. Only 3 you can resolve here. What about the other components? While you can treat your vector here because it is having many components. So that one is a 3-dimensional space. This one is in n-dimensional space. Clear? Okay, example 2.2. An example 2.2 is saying a particle is in infinite square well, has the initial wave function. The initial wave function of our particle is sine x0, means at time t equal to 0, is ax a minus x. For x between 0 and a, and it is equal to means this one, and it has been defined worse. So I let me plot this one, that for some constant, for some constant a, and outside of the well
outside of the well sine x0 is equal to 0 when you are outside of the well. And what is demand? Demand is they calculate sine xt that what this is equal to. So let me plot this one. If this is x and this is sine of x, then sine of x is actually equal to something like this. This is 0, this is a, and it is having certain maximum value, which we will calculate that this is a square over 4. We will calculate this value in a while. Now you know, in order to find out this thing, so you should write the very first equation. And that equation is that you wrote that equation that sine x of t is equal to summation of n from 1 to infinity cn and 2 over a and sine n pi x over a, this one. And then it was having the portion of e minus I e m t over h bar. You remember this one. You wrote, means these are actually the sine n's of x, the bases. This is the coefficient of it. And this one is the time dependent portion. So your total wave function sine x of t will be equal to this, where n is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on. So the very first thing that we will have to find that what are actually CNs. And CN, you know, from Fourier trick you found this thing, that CN is equal to, you remember, from minus infinity to plus infinity, this was equal to sine m conjugate of x and f of x dx. This was equal to this. So you are having, this one is your actually sine n of x. So I am writing now that Cn. Now from minus infinity to plus infinity, this is a general condition. Here we will have it from 0 to a. So from 0 to a, and now psi m conjugate. So this is psi n. I will write psi n, and this is 2 over a, and sine, what is n pi x over a. So this is your psi n of x or psi m of x. M and n are just the indices. And then f of x. F of x is our time independent function. So it will be your psi x 0 here, which is given to us in dx. So put the values and we will have the very first thing. The very first thing we will have to do is to, this one is the basis, which is orthonormal. This wave function should also be normalized. Why? Because in this wave function there is a, which is some constant, which we call the normalization constant. So in order to use it in this equation, a will come here, and our answer will not be right when we don't know the value of a, because this is the coefficient. If the coefficient also come out in terms of a, means another constant, it will be undetermined. So the very first thing will be that we will have to determine this thing.